Hey everyone, this time we're going to be looking at Resident Evil, and this was written by Philip J. Reed. It's part of the Boss Fight book series, and this is a spectacular book. If you're a fan of the Resident Evil video games, or really just horror at all, this is a great book for you to pick up. While Philip uses Resident Evil as sort of a way to advance the story, because the book is largely about the video game, he talks more broadly about the horror genre, which is absolutely great. It's a wonderful book, and it's just spectacular to go through and hear Philip's story and how it relates to the video game. So Philip goes over the history of horror video games. It's not limited to survival horror, but that is kind of where he eventually leads to. But we start out with some of the origins of them, all the way back to Haunted House on the Atari 2600. With Haunted House, you can see where a lot of horror tropes kind of started and where they would be built upon later. It's not the most visually impressive game, and the horror elements are pretty basic, but it is one of those games that kind of started the genre off. I personally think games like 3D Monster Maze probably were more horror-themed and were more survival horror than Haunted House. But it's one of those things where the genre was just getting started, and especially with the 5200 and the 2600, there really weren't defined genres at the time. From here, Philip goes into talking about Alone in the Dark. I don't have access to the game that he played, which was the original Alone in the Dark, so this one is one of the PlayStation 1 versions. The first game in the series is really kind of the foundation for Resident Evil. In later interviews, which Philip talks about in his book, the creator of Resident Evil talked about how Alone in the Dark was really his inspiration for creating Resident Evil. Also is mentioned, you know, Sweet Home did have a big impact as well, as it was supposed to be Resident Evil, but ended up not being used, and they used the template for Alone in the Dark instead. Which is probably a good thing, because I don't know how a role-playing game of Resident Evil would have worked out. Philip doesn't mention Clock Tower, which I think had an impact on the genre as well. At least with Resident Evil 3, but we'll get into that once we eventually get to that game. We then get into a little bit more of the cinematic things behind Resident Evil. Now, it uses FMV at the very beginning, but this is an instance where they do it very, very well. And it's not as good as I think CG or something along those lines would be, but this FMV sequence is really iconic. It's shot beautifully, and it's just really, really cool. So let's go ahead and watch that really quick. When talking about the opening scene, Philip goes into how it plays out a lot like a B-movie. And that's really true, and I hadn't thought about it before, but he's absolutely right.
Alpha team is flying.
From the line readings and through the different camera angles and everything, you can see how it has that sort of early, low-budget horror vibe to it. And going off sort of the low-budget horror movie, Philip brings up repeatedly throughout the book, which is a really good thing, about the different camera angles that are used in the game. And these are kind of used as a way to build suspense and everything, as you're looking at like a fixed camera angle, which doesn't give you a good idea of what's happening around each corner. And he talks about how the director, or the unseen director in the game, is trying to use this as a way to, you know, scare the person playing it in a certain way, kind of getting the right shots at the right angles that he wants in order to build up the tension of the movie. Or in this case, build up the tension of the game. Now, the game is really known for a lot of its line reading, because it's pretty bad, especially when you go back and compare it to more modern line reading, and compare it to how really like voice acting has changed for video games as people start to care a little bit more.
I'll get into that a little bit later as it goes into really some of the Japanese developers taking more time to make sure the lines are actually done right and the translations work out. To be perfectly honest, just going back to the FMV here, I'm really glad that this is done as well as it is. Especially when you compare it to the earlier FMV games where it just was not done right or not done well. I would compare this a little bit closer to like Night Trap, where Night Trap plays off its own B-movie tropes as well, and both of these do it very well, and they definitely do it better than something like Double Switch. I really wanted to call out this really iconic scene here, since Philip does the same thing. This is when you first see the zombie, and it's just so cool, because you don't know that there are really zombies in the game right off the bat, until you get this big reveal, where you walk up, the zombie's eating a guy, and you just get that slow head turn. It just reminds me so much of, like, Night of the Living Dead or some other zombie movie.
He gets into some of the more awkward line readings as well, and this deals a lot with translation that I've talked about a few times before, but let's go ahead and get into it again, because this one, the actors kind of sound like they've all been given concussions before giving their line reading.
So what the heck actually happened with the really terrible dialogue in this game? As Philip goes into it, he sort of uncovers the answer for us, and that's the thing that Capcom didn't really care too much about, you know, how the translation really looked. This was a huge problem with a lot of retro video games, and it just went into more craziness here with Resident Evil. I like to compare this to, you know, some of the really, like, Italian horror movies. Or at least movies that were made by Italians but used American cast. Kind of like with Troll 2, where you get a bunch of terrible line readings. The reason behind that is because the Italian crew that made the movie told all of the actors to just read the lines literally. So don't put any different, you know, inflections or emotion into the lines, and that's why you ended up with those terrible line readings. It's similar here, but it was more of a translation issue where people just did not really get a chance to edit this properly and make the actual lines make sense to an English speaker. The Japanese versions probably made total sense, but when you just translate it literally to English, it's confusing and it's just awkward. Where if you transliterate it, which means take the actual Japanese words, translate them to English, and then translate it again into English that would actually make sense, then you would have gotten a much better, you know, script, and it would have actually all worked out. But unfortunately, that's not what happened here.
So the last thing I wanted to mention in this book is Philip's discussion on how video game sequels and also horror movie sequels, and really horror in general, tends to become less scary as you move farther away from, like, the original date when it was released.
Philip brings up two things in particular. He brings up how in Resident Evil, things sort of changed from more of a, you know, survival horror to like an action horror type game. And he also talks about how, you know, some jokes have been made about really like the Friday the 13th franchise and how the first one was really scary back when it came out, but now it's pretty tame by modern standards. You can compare this to movies like, you know, Nosferatu, like we're watching right now, and how this was really scary back in 1922, but now it's not quite the same. But if you show this to someone who's never seen it before, they might be a little creeped out, a little spooked by it. Whereas, you know, if you've seen this movie multiple times, it's not gonna scare you very much. It's kind of lost that, you know, really ability to scare you, like that first jump scare type thing. And after repeated viewings of a lot of movies, just like repeated playings of a lot of horror video games, they kind of lose their ability to really shock you or scare you. They'll still be entertaining for you, and you'll still enjoy them if that is a genre that you like, but they probably won't give you the same like initial sense of horror or dread or whatever emotion they were trying to pull out of you. It's just this weird thing that happens with horror, but it still doesn't change the fact that the movie or the game or the book that you're reading is still a classic and it still has a lot of meaning for you. The second thing that he talks about is this sort of idea of the monster behind the door. He uses the example of a spider, but I like the idea of there being a monster behind a door and how the movie builds up the tension to where, there's going to be something behind the door. You've seen them opening doors, like in the movie The Thing from 1952. They're constantly opening doors, and you know that at any moment there's going to be the monster right behind it, and you're just waiting and waiting for that to happen, and slowly building up like the creeping suspense and everything. You're just waiting for the second that they open up that door, and bam, there's the monster. And then after that, you don't really have the same thing. You know what the monster looks like. It's not really gonna be a shock or have the same things happen to you as it did the first time.
So, like I said earlier, this is a spectacular book, and I really love how Philip uses a bunch of different forms of media to really get across his point about horror and also bring up some of the things in Resident Evil. It's a great mixture of his own memories playing video games, history of horror, and just a whole bunch of other fun stuff. I really had a lot of fun reading it. I especially love when he talked about, just playing Resident Evil for the first time and how his friend brought it over to another friend's house and the three of them stayed up all night playing it. It just got me thinking back to how I first experienced Resident Evil 2 because it was the same thing. I went over to a friend's house, we rented a copy of Resident Evil 2, and we just played it all night, and it kind of scared the hell out of me every once in a while. So much fun playing that game, and it just brought up a bunch of great memories from, that time in my life. And there were other moments reading this, but that's the one that really stood out to me where I was like, oh my god, I did the same thing. Anyway, guys, that's gonna wrap it up for this episode. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. I loved reading this book. I know I've said it before, but I just really, really loved it. Anyway, guys, I will talk to you all later and have a great day.